Welcome to the service on the Amersham Methodist Circuit YouTube channel. I'm Nigel Wright, I'm one of the ministers in the Amersham Methodist Circuit. We're going to start today's service by being still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Number 20 in Singing the Faith and led by Victoria Methodist Church in Bristol. Number 20. Loving God, we come to praise you here today. You are a great and a wonderful God, and we praise you for the good things that you've done in our lives. On this Mother's Day, we praise you for those who've been a good mother or like a good mother to us. We praise you and we thank you for providing people who have shown us something of your love, who have helped us to become aware of you. We praise you and we worship you, eternal God. But loving God, we confess that so often we take you for granted. At times we can be selfish and self-centered, neglecting each other's needs and thinking of ourselves and our own needs alone. And so, Lord, as well as coming to praise and to thank you, we also come to ask for forgiveness. And we thank you for your promise of forgiveness. We thank you for your gracious love to your children who so often lack faith. We thank you for the creation of the heavens and the earth. We thank you for Jesus Christ and the example of his life. For the privilege of following him and living the new life that he offers. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the inspirer of faith and revealer of truth. And on this Mothering Sunday, we thank you for the church or the churches that have nurtured and taught us and given us glimpses of you. And loving God, we give you our thanks now for all that you've done for us. Amen. And we continue in prayer as we say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we're going to continue to thank and to praise God in our next hymn. It's number 81 in Singing the Faith, and is going to be led by Matt Beckingham. Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices. Number 81.
And hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom this world rejoices, who from a mother's arms has blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is us today. Oh, may this bounteous God through all our life be near us, with ever joyful hearts and blessed peace to cheer us, and keep us in His grace, and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. All praise and thanks to God the Father now be given, the Son and His was, is now, and shall be evermore.
The lectionary reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, and it's a very familiar parable that Jesus told. And Heather Wright from St. John's Methodist Church is going to read it to us. Luke chapter 15, first of all verses 1 to 3, and then verses 11b to 32.
Luke chapter 15, verses 1 to 3 and 11 to 32. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off to the distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. For while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Amen.
That story is about being lost and found, about God's amazing grace, which we're going to sing about now. Number 440, 440 in Singing the Faith, Amazing Grace, which will be led by Ruth and Joy Everingham.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. God's grace has taught my heart His grace, my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, I have already come. God's grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord as long as life endures. And when this heart and flesh shall fail, and mortal life shall cease, I shall possess within than when we first begun.
I love that passage from Luke's Gospel. There's so much depth to it, and so much to tell us about God's love. But I do wonder what title you would give that parable. And I ask you because there are a number of different titles that it goes under. One title for it is of a prodigal son, a title which concentrates on the spendthrift son, the son who wastes his share of a father's estate. But there are other titles too. I've heard of it being referred to as the parable of a prodigal father, because what the father did in welcoming his son back would have been regarded as absolutely scandalous in his society. And there's also the title of the lost son. And if we use that title and call it the parable of a lost son, that title is actually a lot more subtle than it looks at first sight. And it's a lot more subtle than it looks at first sight because which son comes to mind when we think of this parable? When we talk about this parable about being lost and found, which son comes into our minds? It's the younger son who we usually think about first, the one who went away and spent his share of the inheritance, the one who squandered his money and came back with his tail between his legs, begging for forgiveness. But if we think about this parable a bit more, if we think about it a bit more carefully, there's not one lost son, but two. And then when we think about it a bit more, the son who is lost, the son who is really lost, is not the prodigal, the spendthrift, because he's come home. He was lost, but is now found. The one who is really lost is the one who has never left home in the first place, the older brother. And we're not told whether the older brother has returned home, and that's because Jesus has deliberately left it vague. And he's left it vague because of who he is addressing this parable to. If we look back at the start of the 15th chapter of Luke's Gospel, it's obvious who's being addressed. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, and they're having a good moan about him. They're criticising him because he was a man who welcomed sinners and who ate with them. He was a man who deliberately made contact with the people at the edge of society, people who were looked down upon, people who weren't respectable. And in response to all of that muttering and grumbling, Jesus told them a series of parables, a series of stories about being lost and found, about the lost sheep, about the lost coin, and about the lost son. And Jesus is aiming this straight at the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, and he's asking them to come home to God too. He's placing them in the position of the older brother. And it's the older brother who I want to have a look at today. And I want to have a look at some of the reasons why he may have been unhappy with his siblings' return home. Because when we look at the parable, there's so much jealousy and so much bitterness in it. And maybe he was jealous. Jealous about the honour that his father had given to his younger brother with those symbols of a robe and a ring and a fattened calf, a calf that had been fattened especially for the next big family occasion. Jealous, maybe, because he felt that his brother was getting it easy, because he'd slaved away for his father. And that, if we look at the text, is part of his complaint. And he says that he's slaved away for years. And I'm not using that phrase in English to exaggerate or emphasise his feelings. That's what it says in the Greek too. Maybe he felt his brother was getting it easy. that he hadn't had to do the work that he had done. Maybe he felt he hadn't had to work all the years that he had worked, and so in his eyes, his brother did not deserve to be forgiven until he'd proven himself. And maybe the Pharisees and the teachers of the law against whom this parable was aimed were jealous. Jealous maybe because some of the people coming back to God appeared to have experienced God's love, perhaps in a way that they had never ever experienced themselves. And didn't like the fact that people like these, people they looked down upon, people who perhaps weren't as well educated as them, people who are on the edges of their society, these people were being touched by God. Perhaps, like the older brother, it felt as if these people were getting away with it. As if these people hadn't toiled away for years for God, but were being let into God's kingdom simply because God was a God of love and a God of mercy. And they didn't like it. It just didn't seem fair. And jealousy can be behind some people's unwillingness in the church to use the gifts of others, because we feel that those people should not have the particular gifts they have, because somehow in our eyes they don't deserve them because they haven't worked for the kingdom like we have. Or maybe because of some prejudice, we feel that God shouldn't work in that way. And maybe if jealousy is one of the reasons behind an unwillingness to use particular people's gifts, maybe some of that jealousy comes out of bitterness. Bitterness, perhaps, because people have never really experienced God and God's love themselves, despite being involved with the church throughout their lives, despite trying to serve God, or perhaps because they've lost sight of God. And the bitterness of the older brother is one thing that strikes home from this story that Jesus told. And the bitterness is so obvious at the end of the parable. The elder brother is absolutely furious with his father about the treatment of his brother who has returned home. Look at what it says. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. And when his father went out to him, he answered, "I've been slaving away for years for you, but I've never disobeyed you. But you haven't even given me a young goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when your son came home," note those words, "didn't refer to him as my brother. He's so eaten up by his bitterness that he calls his brother your son. When your son comes home," you can almost hear the sneer in his voice, "when your son came home, you killed the fattened calf for him." And later on, the bitterness had soured him so much that he accused his brother of wasting the money on prostitutes. Was his imagination running wild? I don't know about you, but I do have a certain amount of sympathy for the older brother. He'd never left home, always been there. He'd been faithful to his father, not left for straight and narrow, or not much anyway. And it must have been tempting to have done some of the things that his brother had done, or he imagined that his brother had done. And then his younger brother comes home and is treated like a king. And the Pharisees and the teachers of the law against whom this parable was aimed were not on the whole wicked men. They'd remained faithful to God. They'd obeyed the law down to the smallest detail. But some of them, I imagine, were bitter about what Jesus was doing. But why? Why should they be bitter? Why should the older brother be bitter? Why should all that come about? Perhaps it was because the relationship between the older son and his father seems to be one of duty. There appears to be no love on the part of the son. And bitterness can so easily come out of dutiful relationships if there is no love. If someone has looked after a relative out of a sense of duty and out of a sense of of duty alone, then there can be a sense of bitterness there. And the same is true with our relationship with God. If we've been a dutiful churchgoer, but have no love for God, and we've had no experience of God's love for us, then in that situation there can be a sense of bitterness if anyone dares criticise what we do. There can be a sense of bitterness if anything is changed. There can be a sense of bitterness about other people's gifts and an unwillingness to use them because they threaten us. And where we are worshipping God out of duty rather than out of love, and I realise that for most of us it probably is mixed at times. At times we do come to church out of duty or habit, and don't get me wrong, it's a good habit to get into. But where we worship God purely out of duty and always out of duty and never out of love, then we can become exactly like the older son in the parable, bitter and twisted and lost and separated from God, left with an empty faith, left with the trappings of religion, but without the depth of love that comes from a faith in a living and a loving God. Now, a sense of duty is, of course, important. It can keep us going when we don't feel like doing something, because if we base everything on our emotions and what we feel like, and whether we feel like doing something, then we become unreliable and a real pain to everyone else. If preachers just relied on a sense of feeling, there would be times we wouldn't turn up to lead services of worship, because there are some Sunday mornings when I could quite easily turn over in bed and go back to sleep. And a sense of duty and a sense of responsibility is needed in living life as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus Christ, because at times it is tough. It's tough to go on serving, it's tough to keep on loving, it's tough to carry on caring, it's tough at times to follow wherever God calls us. And a sense of duty and a sense of responsibility can help us to keep going. But if it's always only done out of duty, and if there's never any love there, if it's not shot through with God's love in the things that we do and what we say, then it becomes an intolerable burden. And perhaps that's what's happened to the older son. Perhaps it had become an intolerable burden. And what made it worse for him was that he hadn't realised that that's what had happened. And in the process of his loveless duty, he'd become lost. His younger brother had recognised that he had become lost. He had recognised his position for what it was, that he was lost and that it was better to be back at home where he belonged. But the older brother perhaps had never realised but he could become just as lost as his younger brother, but without ever leaving home. After all, how could he get lost if he hadn't ever left home? But he could, just as the Pharisees and the teachers of the law could, just as we in the church can. We can become so busy with doing things for the church that we lose sight of the God who is behind the body of Christ. And perhaps those of us who are part of a church and have always been part of a church and have been part of a church throughout our lives are more likely to become lost in the same way as the older brother if serving God becomes a duty rather than a loving response to his love for us. But if we do become lost, whether it's because we've deliberately turned away from God or because our service of God has gradually become a duty, or if it's always been a duty and a duty alone, and we're just as lost and apart from God in all of those situations. Remember how the father reacted to both brothers. Because usually we only think about that wonderful image of a father rushing out to meet his wayward son. And it is a wonderful image. But we so easily forget that the father came out to both sons, came out to both brothers. He came out to the older brother as well, coming out to him to try to persuade him to celebrate his brother's return home. Because God wants everyone to return home, to come home, to return to Him. And when we are lost or turn away from Him, He is there waiting for us to come back. And if we take the other two parables in this series from Luke chapter 15, the parables about the lost sheep and the lost coin, together with a parable of a lost son, we see a God who doesn't only wait for people to come back to Him, but who actively goes out looking for them. But if we do feel the same way about people coming back to God as the older brother, if we don't have a passion for other people to come back to God, if we are jealous about what other Christians appear to have, or if we are bitter about how we have served God and feel that we haven't been rewarded, then maybe we are the ones who are really lost, who have become lost. And maybe we are the ones who need to be aware that we have become lost and that we need to turn back to God. And if any of us are in that situation, then God wants us to return home to Him too. And remember that He will welcome us back with open arms. Amen. Enlarge, inflame, and fill my heart with boundless charity divine. So shall I all my strength exert, and love them with a zeal like thine, and lead them to thy open side, the sheep for whom their shepherd died. We're going to echo the words of Charles Wesley now as we sing our next hymn, number 661 from Singing the Faith. Give me the faith which can remove, which Southcliffe Methodist Church from Scarborough will lead us in. Number 661, Give Me the Faith Which Can Remove. We're now going to pray for other people and for ourselves. So let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you that you are faithful. And we thank you that you are waiting for us to return home whenever we stray. Whether we become lost through deliberately turning away from you, or if we have gradually lost sight of you in our day-to-day lives, we thank you that you come out looking for us too. And Almighty God, we pray for all who are lost, both those within and outside the church. We pray too for those who have no faith in you, that they will become aware of your presence in their lives. And eternal God, we pray for your church throughout the world. We pray for our local churches and for the church that we are part of, that you will help us to reach out with your love to those around us. We thank you for those churches that have nurtured us over the years in our faith, and we pray that those who are currently part of those churches will continue to nurture each other and will seek out ways of nurturing others in the Christian faith. Suffering God, we pray for all those who are in pain or distress. We pray for those who are on our hearts and minds in a few moments of silence. We pray that your love may nourish and heal them, strengthen and encourage them. Pray particularly for all those in the Ukraine and in Russia who are suffering from the effects of war. We pray for the leaders of those two nations that they will seek to bring about a fair and a lasting peace in the Ukraine. And loving God, we pray for those who are on our hearts and minds. In a few moments of silence, and we bring them to you. And loving God, we pray for all who are mothers. Pray for your guidance and for your wisdom about how best they can love their children. We pray too for all for whom Mother's Day is a sad or a difficult occasion for whatever reason, that they will be aware of your presence with them. And renewing God, we pray for ourselves, that you will bless and revitalize our lives, that you will help us to keep ourselves open to you and your healing love, and that you will continue to guide us in our service and our witness to you. Loving God, we make these our prayers, in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we're going to end with a hymn about love. A hymn about God's love. A hymn which invites God to place that love within each one of us. It's number 503, number 503 in Singing the Faith, sung by Frodsham Methodist Church Choir. Love divine, all loves excelling. Loving Father, full of compassion, merciful Saviour, full of grace, life-giving Spirit, full of power, fill our hearts, our minds, and our souls with your love, and send us out to build your kingdom. And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.